Well, he's the favorite to serve here, starting it off with the first two. Love all. Clean backhand. Now, can you tell us a little bit about some of the dangerous points of the Silent Assassin's game?
First thing that comes to mind is that flick. Can do it from even the forehand side with side spin or top spin. Sometimes when it comes around it so much, it even seems to have a backspin effect because a player who tries to attack it goes into the bottom of the net.
It is crazy if you can attack the ball with mostly side spin. Players are used to top spin coming in. It's the most conventional way to attack and the most secure way, really. It takes a lot of practice to attack with less top spin. And a break, a little home court advantage here for Liang Jingquan. Now, for those of you a little newer to the sport, the flick or the flip, depending on where you are in the world, is an attack from inside the table where you don't have room for a full swing. It's a very wristy shot, especially from the backhand side. Liang Jingquan controlling right now. Now, another thing I think that would probably be one of the first things that comes to mind with Lin Wenru is how smooth he is in his transitions. But in this point, I mean, that's very uncharacteristic. That's because Liang Jingquan is really pinning him in uncomfortable spots. Flawless start right now from Liang Jingquan.
God, you could feel so much potential energy before he made that backhand, and he just unleashed into it. The beast from the Far East, Liang Jingquan.
Not so far east of here, though. I'm just kidding. I mean, his service game has been incredible. I like your nickname, by the way. It's just fun to be here in China and saying that when you think about directions. But from a service standpoint, Lin Wenru looking for that Chiquita. He's looking to get in. Most serves will come half long, more middle of the table, something that's a bit unpredictable. And Lin Wenru is so strong over the table with that banana flick. And even here, how well prepared can you be for this shot?
That's nuts. I mean, Lin Wenru could have played a better forehand there. Liang Jingquan makes him pay the price by asking questions of the recovery. Lin Wenru couldn't recover from in to out.
And a break off the top of the net as well. Right now, the crowd seems to be quite behind Liang Jingquan.
I mean, for me, Lin Wenru seems like one of the most impossible players to bagel because he's just so complete, so tricky.
It's almost like a penalty kick every time if this were football. And look at Wang Chuqin here. Lim Shidong in the background. Wow. That is probably the best response I've ever heard to someone on screen. Just like a man sitting on a rooftop in sunshine. First point, Liang Jingquan really going for a run there near the barriers. Yeah, Wang Chuqin was watching that with the satisfaction and support that I think the fans knew. He could have been like bitter and bah humbug about the guy that beat him, but there was just so much team spirit and love in that look.
Four, nine.
Such a reassuring kind of look, wasn't it? It was like, I know he's got this.
Andy Dufresne watching his friends enjoy the beer on the rooftop. But second point, it's Lin Wenru making his way back in. Nice change of direction.
Three.
I mean, Liang Jingquan, think about how he was playing before. Lin Wenru just couldn't even get into the point. But he's managed to change that. He's forced his way in, found some answers early on. Any little glimpse of hope or a chance to attack or play with control, he's using. Back edge of the table, Lin Wenru continues with his fourth straight point.
Some bandaging here of the wounding effect of Liang Jingquan's opening, 8 points?
Nine. That would be a disagreement in German. Oh, another one! Wang Yidi had her fair share of fortune in the last match, but here, a game that was looking like a runaway, when you think of Liang Jingquan coming back against Hugo Calderano with the world champs from down 0-3, you think anything is possible if he can do that against the world number 5.
Maybe he even surprised himself a little bit, Liang.
It's one of those things where you can't really look back. You just have to stay focused. Perfect placement on this one. Liang Jingquan getting the wild shot out of Lin Wenru earns himself 5 game points in the first game here in this best of 7 men's singles semifinal. Outstanding play. The grunts all pay off. Game two, best of seven. Lin Wenrue down 0-1.
One.
Much better start than the last game.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, then every point seems like a marathon against Lin Wenrue, even if you're Liang, because of the amount of quality he puts on every single shot.
And six of the last 8 points for Lin Wenrue. That's a very well-protected opening spin shot. Again, it's the beware of dog sign on the fence. It's knowing what's waiting on the other side of the table. This shot isn't tough to make. It's tough to make well.
That's a good point.
Outstanding. Again, Lin Wenrue brings in a quality with his fluid game and even stronger base than he used to have, but well calibrated on the other side. Liang Jingquan, watch this.
Look at the transfer there, the rotation in the waist from right leg through to left. Textbook table tennis, the Chinese silhouette.
And deep to the backhand there, the opposite spin of the bottle challenge, but similar placement.
It's funny, isn't it? It's straight out the table tennis textbook, but yet so few can actually read it and actually make sense of it.
Yeah, he does a wonderful job of disguising.
Three.
Nice wide angle there. Didn't take a huge shot. Just stretches Liang. Another huge sweet spot player, especially on the backhand side.
That service toss completely got away from him. It must have caught the finger on the way up or something. He's still shaking his head. I mean, when have you ever seen body language like this way behind the head? And he was outside the table, too. He might have, I mean, whether he crossed the baseline or not, wasn't called. But he got away playing out the point here.
Dismissive power from Liang. I don't know. Maybe the slower spins are going to be a little bit less effective from Lin Wenrue against a player who can just counter so consistently like that.
It's a good point. He really does secure his opportunities and make it more challenging to play him. A little bit more shallow on the table. You can see a very excited Liang Jingquan ready to snap back, but had to play it out in front. Again, the in and out game. A lot of ways to catch your opponent off guard, take them out of position. It's amazing. Liang Jingquan can hit that hard, recharge, do it again and again. Wow. Xiao Zhan there, Wang Hao here, we saw Liu Ding Shuo. Wang Chuqin watching. It was the most facial hair I had ever seen on Xiao Zhan. Throughout this point, though, I mean, you feel like at some point he's going to have to counter back, and he felt it too. Lin Wenrue trying to get back in with a bit of aggression of his own, not just blocking.
That was served well. You never know where that Lin Wenrue serve is going to go, really. Saw him surprise Ruin Phyllis with it yesterday so many times.
It's one of the biggest parts of his game. I mean, he's incredibly effective in the serve. I'm sure we'll get some stats at some point about points won on serve. But Lin Wenrue right now just having a tough time with such a strong receiver on the other side.
6-5.
One step in the right direction for the silent assassin here. Here. As they both breathe on their racket, clean it off. Keep the hands dry as well. Wow. Took a lot of work in this point. That early backhand wide opened up the four or the other side. Look at the Lebrons and Gauzy here, the French contingency on the men's side.
The flick and then recovers the wide base, helps him get the balance there, and then bends the wrist just to manipulate the ball with a bit of side out wide.
I love the way Lin Wenrue plays that ball, reaching out in front so that it comes back that much quicker. Here it is, percentage of points won on serve almost double for Liang Jingquan, and still only half. I mean, again, the receive game strong of these two, but by percentages, Liang Jingquan's much stronger right now.
six,
but you have to remember the statistic includes shots like this. It includes long rallies. The receive doesn't automatically outright win the point. In the open rally, Liang Jingkun is so well, just so well balanced. He's fast and he's powerful on both wings. Tough time out there for Lin Winru. Little fortune for Liang Jingkun.
Goes for the bottle challenge. Misses it. Big, big error there, and it could cost him, especially mentally, some energy.
Well, definitely not intended. I think he had to take the risk. Can't fault him for that. Don't block your friend's wave. You can be shy. You can't be shy for your friend. That was nothing but shy. Nothing even close to shy. It was the opposite. This was loud. It was very attention-grabbing. A backhand like that cannot be ignored. 3 points in front now, Liang Jingkun.
There's a dead effect of the Lin Winru flick when he comes around the side of it so much there's barely any topspin. Venom in the wrist.
So I think you were on the side of the majority with the fans here favoring Lin Winru. What do you think it's going to take from Lin Winru to turn this around?
I don't know. I mean, for me, one of the big things that made me think Lin Winru could win this was the fact that he's a lefty. And against a player like Lin, sometimes you need to play them a couple of times before you can get used to the quality. And this is their first meeting, but Liang is doing so well. Let's say their second meeting.
Ten,
right.
Eight.
Only once before they've played. It was Liang Jingkun who won that. Yeah. A little bit of the edge here in the rally. It's also interesting to me in terms of the lefty thing. Wow. From where he hit the ball, it seemed clear that it must have touched the top of the table.
Ten, eight.
Had he been a little bit farther out on the backhand side, would have been easier to actually catch the side of the table, in which case it would have been Liang Jingkun's point. Now for me, the freeness that we're seeing in that opening shot, I feel like it's going to have to be something to do with bravery. You know, we saw Fan Zhendong in his interview after beating Lin Shedong in a five-gamer that came down to the wire. He just started taking the initiative. But for a while, it almost felt like he was being bullied and controlled by the 17-year-old Lin Shedong. Game point once again, Liang Jingkun. That is an incredible shot. Do not toss the ball from inside the end line of the table. A lot of work here in a chop block to set it up.
That is sensational play. Feeling from the silent assassin. Then just merciless power. There are the shoes. Good start here. And he needed a good start. Again, even though we're in a best of seven, it feels kind of like a must-win game here for Lin Winru, even though we've seen comebacks from 3-0 down. Phyllis, for example, against Lin at the Almaty final before Lin got revenge yesterday.
That is scary. Absolutely terrifying how good Liang Jingkun is in this point. I thought Lin Winru did everything perfectly to place the ball, to keep control of the point, and yet somehow Liang Jingkun with that wide base was always in position and able to regain control of the point.
A trend that we've been seeing is that Lin Winru has won the shorter rallies and Liang is winning the longer ones.
What do you think that is? Why do you think that is?
Well, I think that Lin Winru has more quality in the serve and receive, but Liang is better kind of at recovering and then finding a shot after a longer rally to make a winner.
It's interesting. He has been really strong in the rallies, no doubt about it. But as you've said, and accurately in my opinion, Liang Jingkun's feeling is outstanding. You talk about him as having so much touch for a guy who's one of the most explosive players in the game. And despite his stocky figure and big upper body, he also covers ground so well.
Yeah.
I mean, rarely can you find him out of position or off balance.
Such a grafter, Liang Jingkun. Looks like he's come off the building site after a few bacon butties. But yeah,
So it really only goes to show you that a player with so much touch, as you've acknowledged in Liang Jingquan, to be out-touched in the serve-receive game, or at least receive anyway, statistically we know serves have favored Liang Jingquan. It just goes to show you how good the feeling is of Lin Wenru.
Absolutely. They're so well matched, but in different ways.
Do you have their specifics of their last encounter?
Yeah, I'll gather it up in a second.
Sure. That backhand has so much juice, so much power behind it, the spin and the speed. To finish a rally going backhand to forehand with Lin Wenru.
And he's just pushed a topspin serve. From his forehand side with the backhand. I mean, come on.
That's the feeling you're talking about. Beautiful point. Lin Wenru down the line with the backhand.
Blistering pace. It's almost like the ball's on a string and it's choreographed before the rally starts.
Wow. Reaction like that. I can't recall seeing a reaction like that from Liang Jingquan. It was almost like a what?
Nice there. Guess you expect Lin Wenru to play the flick. Comes in with the open racket face, but then last second changes to the push, and that's the surprise factor that's going to help him beat the seemingly unbeatable Liang Jingquan.
Ah, to the depths of the table. The deepest part of that corner is able to just skate it past and under the racket.
Just to fill you all in with the last encounter, it was in 2018. So not as kind of reliable to reference as if they played in 2022, last season, for example. Long time ago.
To put things into perspective, Lin Wenru currently 21 years old, so 2018, I mean, we're talking 16, 17 years old versus a player who was in his young 20s at the time. A lot happens between those years in developing internationally. It's part of the reason you see so many junior world champions or youth world champions that you never hear of.
5-7.
Making it in the big leagues in the adult game takes a real incredible leap. Zhang Wujin has done it. Lin Shidong has done it. No question about that. Extra quality here on that opening backhand.
Yeah, venom there again. Kind of more archy ball, which can be difficult to get over the top of. It's a bit loopier in baseline.
Parallel again. It's not the first time we've seen a bit of surprise on that down the line play. Lin Wenru, look at the scoreboard now, up by 4. In what we feel would be a must-win game in terms of a real shot, especially because Ruben Filus was the one who came back from down 0-3. Service percentage here, much closer. Liang Jingquan. Kim Young-ju sees the end line better than anybody in the game. It's interesting. I mean, players, this is what you do normally. You get as close to the call as you can without getting called. We can talk about that for a bit, but maybe we'll save it for a bit later, because right now the Silent Assassin has 5 game points for his first game on the scoreboard. And only needs that one after winning 6 of the last 8 points before Lin Wenru. So Lin Wenru with the momentum in a serious way here starts off game 4 on the other side of the table. Big backhand. I thought from the start of this point he hadn't got it in. Like, hadn't really put himself in a position to win the point.
Yeah.
But nice recovery, and again, that backhand to save him from behind the table. We see you, Cloud Walker fan.
Well, a winner there into the backhand, but I feel like Lin Wenru's pressured the forehand of Liang Jingquan very, very well. Because obviously Liang, and well, any player really, it's a less expensive stroke, the backhand side.
From the first point mostly, or the last several sets of points?
The last several sets. You can see he's trying to pin the backhand in the last couple, but getting early with the flick and play a couple of balls into the forehand of Leanne. It's more difficult to recover a forehand to play another forehand than it is to recover to play a backhand from a backhand.
Right, that's when we say the more expensive stroke, meaning it costs you more time.
3-1.
And in a game that's so fast, time is a very, well, valuable commodity to have out here. Not an endless resource of time. This is why you see such strong legs and waists and core strength of these players. 11 of the last 16 for Lin Wenru. Very encouraging percentage there.
3-1.
Or fraction of points. Again, just drying his hand on the table. They'll typically do that near the net or on the side of the table where the ball's unlikely to bounce. The quality in these counters.
Blistering pace. He's using the shovel serve wonderfully, Lin. And that's a serve that you barely see Liang ever do, the shovel serve. Either with the reverse or the pendulum he chooses to do.
I feel like Lin Shedong and Fan Zhendong a few times we saw starting to do that just the other day. Now for me, tactically, this is still right. Lin Wenru has found a fair amount of success being very clear at when he's going to make his opening attack. And when it is, even if he has to take a ball early off the bounce, he's going to be very confident and fearless in that attack. Because if he plays it lukewarm or too steady, Liang Jingquan will just take control of the point. Two serving four, Liang Jingquan.
I can't help but think, Adam, even though Liang Jingquan got off to that 9-0 start in game one, it can be hard to mentally recover from that, as well as it was for Lin Wenru.
Hard to recover for Lin Wenru.
And Liang, say you win game one 11-0.
Okay.
The pressure to win after that, if you can't control it, can be quite difficult to manage.
This isn't that I agree with you, but I think this is something that as spectators, the pros have just gotten so good at putting the past behind them. I mean, how many times has a player been up 10-4 and lost? It's memorable, but 10-7 all the time. It happened twice to Christian Carlsen in the same match against Lin Shedong, and they still, you know, they come back and they fight.
6-3.
Interesting. Wang Hao, legend. Another pen holder like Marlin.
Except with the best RPB we've ever seen. The reverse pen hold backhand. Didn't invent it, but sure mastered it. Tough way to get into a point, but Lin Wenru knew that he had to go for the big counter on the move. He took his chances. Again, if you can't change the pass, no point in worrying about it, but doing his best to recover. Slipped out to that wide forehand. Liang Jingquan within 2 points now.
It was around the net territory.
You can still feel this, that every shot he takes once they get into the open rally, this is why it's nice to be young and physically fit, that you can play multiple shots as hard as you can from behind the table. Every time he has the chance, nothing is in between. Not in previous rallies, but forced into more passive, reactive play. I think that was quite interesting. Push coming just a little bit long. Very smart and patient play from Liang Jingquan to wait for that ball to come off the table. And he come in and pushed it back, which is quite tempting. It was a half-long push.
Yeah.
Had he done that, Lin Wenru would have been in a very good position to follow up with the attack.
And he may have been in that final forehand that he missed if Liang had not gone more into the middle. It just seems to me like one of, if not the most suffocating serve as a right-hander to try and receive. That one there that Minmu just played. And that's not with hindsight either.
Just a general opinion from over the years that you've witnessed, and understandably so. So the Ung Jin Kwin here, patiently waiting, goes short side. Again, he's able, I mean, I thought that was a good setup from Lin Win Ru to get him out of position, to get Liang Jingquan over and expose that deep backhand corner.
6-9.
It was a bit of a premature chole, at least from that camera angle. It seemed like the ball could have come down, but from Lin Win Ru's point of view, he's going to have a much clearer sense. Yep. Nah, he's right on time. I don't think I've ever seen a premature chole from the silent assassin. I mean, some people are still getting used to the fact that he says chole. Beautiful backhands out in front. And now it is 4 game points to not only level the playing field and equal the score in games, but cause some real concern for a strong opponent 3 spots up in the world ranking from the most dominant team in the history of table tennis.
10-7.
1 game point saved here, the touch play from your man with the feeling.
Might just have the best touch play in the world, Liang Jingquan, at the moment.
A 10.
It's funny, it could be overshadowed even by all the other skills he brings to the table. You don't look at the guy and think touch player. And in terms of the big shots, the viral videos that people see on the internet around the world of these players.
8-10.
I mean, I'm sure you've seen a hand switch roller from Lin Win Ru. He's got some outstanding feeling as well, but you're right. Liang Jingquan working his way back in. Got the serves back on his side. 2 game points saved. 2 more to go for the silent assassin. And that is some smart table tennis. And smooth under pressure, Liang Jingquan with his third, and it sends Lin Win Ru. All right, back. 1 more game point, Lin Win Ru. Let's see how his hand holds up. And a good serve, gutsy serve, long to the forehand. Liang Jingquan with his 4th straight point saves game points.
That is a very bold, ambitious, and well-executed serve from Liang Jingquan.
Couldn't agree with you more. And now the score, deuce, in game number 4.
10-0.
Alternating serves now until one player has a 2-point lead to ultimately take this game.
11.
And it just hasn't been the same. I feel like since that hand injury, we just haven't seen quite the same control from Lin Win Ru. 6 of the last 8 points for Liang Jingquan, and now he's got a game point of his own. Big backhand, it's been a while for Lin Win Ru. And a bit of vocalization there.
I feel like Liang was a bit tentative there on the block, almost like he was just trying to gauge how Lin Win Ru was feeling in a way.
Yeah, he didn't go for a big counter, and he didn't go for just a gentle block either. He did seem caught in between two minds. Back at deuce. Top edge of the racket, the heavy topspin. Liang Jingquan changing in the in and out game. Just a little bit more shallow, but excellent spin.
Contained, and that one, he knows he can come over the top of Liang Jingquan. Brilliant shot selection and patient play there initially, even though a bomb to finish.
Game point again. Perfect setup, and he keeps fighting. I'm still thinking about that replay. It's amazing to me that in these rallies, Liang Jingquan, yeah, he's a powerful guy, but a finishing shot, and if you looked at the range of motion on his forehand, it was a very minimal stroke. He didn't have a big backswing. It wasn't like he swung for the fences like he was trying to rip it. Look how similar their serve percentage is now. Lin Win Ru has been really taking advantage of his service game. And for the third time, deuce.
Oh.
Not an easy way to win a point. It took two very high pressure shots, and Lin Minru on top of them both.
It's just blistering, isn't it? Scarring. I think that's where working the weight room has really helped Lin Minru.
Yes. I've had a chance, a privilege, to see him with his strength and conditioning coach in Elon. The different work he's gone through, but physically he's a different character now. Backhand does it, and a very calm. Although it would be unusual and entertaining.
Comes really over that exaggerated movement, Lin Minru. Thinking about how you follow through after your contact on the ball can actually help your technique when you hit it.
Yeah, I feel like for players coming into the game, it's the type of thing, if you're working with the coach, if you're analyzing yourself, at the same time at this level, I feel like technique, as a wise man told me, technique is whatever works. And for Timo Boll, he doesn't have textbook technique, and it works incredibly well for him. You do what you have to do.
Couldn't agree more. I mean, there's a lot of coaches out there that want to try and make their players look a certain way when they play, and that's hugely problematic and something that they need to really rethink, because each player has something special, and that man there has a few things.
Well, two men there, Omar Hasar in the front, and the person who ended his Olympic run, Ma Long behind him, the greatest of all time, watches on in support. Lin Minru with the chop block for an outright point. Wow, the score line right now. This is fascinating. Again, whatever works. How many coaches are going to tell you to do this shot? Don't get me wrong, when we were talking about coaching advice, 7 of the last 8 points for a player who's pulled out some creativity when need be. And it depends on coaches in different places, right? I mean, the most dominant nation in the world in table tennis is China. And you don't see them having quite the same free open play as, say, the French team. So it's working quite fine, nothing to be faulted there. But as spectators, we love a bit of creativity. Reverse pendulum here. Yang Jingquan quick to follow with two big backhands.
Yeah. No question about the nature of Liang Jingquan. He's an alpha, isn't he, at the table? And in general, you get that aura about him.
That he takes the initiative early in the point. 2 points in a row from Liang Jingquan. And make that three. Timeout has already been called. Now it's interesting, an injury timeout is technically different than a timeout. But my understanding is Lin Minru called a timeout first. And then it was an injury timeout. We'll find out. If he ends up calling a timeout later, then we'll know that it didn't count as a timeout.
I've seen some pretty sus medical timeouts. I'm not going to say by who, because it's going to get me in big, big trouble.
You can't do that. It's okay. That's hilarious. Seen a lot of shady behavior from certain players whose names I can't mention. Anyway, 4 points apiece. Liang Jingquan right back in it.
Look at this turnaround here. Is that 5 in a row?
Yes, it is. We got a chop block at 3-0, I think, from Lin Minru to go up 4-0, but since then, not a point. Now, behind the table by that far, it's going to be really tough. It's easier said than done. It's almost like telling someone, oh, you should just try winning more. They're like, thank you, I never thought of that. Being closer to the table is a big advantage in table tennis because your opponent has less time to react. Obviously, you do too. But if you can play the shot near the table, you have wider angles, more choices, less time for your opponent. And he's trying to stay closer here. Inside the table, he's incredibly strong. But what a turnaround here. 7 in a row for Liang Jingquan, who took the first 9 points. So 7 of the last 8. Only one of them has gone to Lin Minru. From 3-0 up. A lot of pressure here. Throws his whole body at this one to get that forehand down the line into play.
Good depth there on the backhand. But yeah, I think the fact that Liang Jingquan has changed to the reverse pendulum is helping him, because now gives Lin Minru some side spin to try and work against, to deny Liang whatever he wants, the forehand or the backhand. Unless you really control the receive against side spin, your opponent can get what they want on the third ball.
Note to self for all you players up and coming to be prepared for left-handed players, work on your reverse pendulum serve.
7.
Big rally here, and once again, it started to feel like a runaway after 7 in a row. But a timeout now on Liang Jingquan's side. That if you spend here, you can take off until tomorrow. Do all the preparation you need.
6.
But a half-long serve right near the baseline. Lin Yunru appearing to go for it, but the placement was just perfect from Liang Jingquan.
Yeah. Just maybe thought a little bit too prematurely, or acted a bit too early. Lin Yunru. Like he could have played a forehand off that ball, potentially coming over the top of it.
Would have been tough. Mm. Excellent serve. 2 points down now.
6-9.
Not sure what the acknowledgement was for, but clearly a bit of fortune for Liang Jingquan. We'll see here.
Maybe a top edge of the racket.
Yeah, it seems possible. Interesting, when you said Liang, there was a Liang on screen massaging the hand of Lin Yunru, Chen Liang. Big 9, backhand in the 7. Middle, closing in this gap, that 3-point lead down to 2 in the serves. Again, the serve game has been strong from Liang Jingquan, but service game has been more even between these two as we've gotten deeper in the match. Anything is possible. Game 5, this is where Liang Jingquan broke ahead against Lin Shidong in Goa. Top edge of the racket, it's the spin game of near the table. Liang Jingquan, 10-7, 1 point away from taking this game for a 3-2 lead. The reverse pendulum serve, beautiful bend on the backhand before this. The variety that he brings in those shots, 3 game points.
Left, 10-7.
I'm seeing a lot of pros now going for an intentionally bouncy serve, tight and low to the net.
Now you're going to have to help me understand that a bit. Bouncy serve, when you say bouncy serve and tight and low to the net, it's a little tough to comprehend. Can you elaborate?
So it's almost the effect of serving more into the table, into your side of the table, that can create that. But then the trajectory of it's lower at a little bit of a later point. So it looks to be bouncy, but then ends up being low to the net.
Interesting. 8 serving 10, Lin Yunru. And it's Liang Jingquan who takes it 11-8. Who actually gave a good example of the serve you were describing for the last serve of last game. Top of the net and out. But yeah, we did see him serve a ball that was closer to his baseline. Typically, that would get you a long serve. This one just a little bit out in front for a half long.
I think it's a serve with a slightly bouncy effect, even though it is tight and low, that can make the opponent mistime a flick or a push.
1-4.
See how much topspin was on that, even though it came down on the wrong side of the table. Subsequently, jumped over the net.
Jumping back to 2018, just thought I'd say Liang won it 4-2.
Good detail.
4-1.
A very closed racket of Lin Yunru. It's going to be such a fine margin shot, the opening. And just a quick guide, Liang Jingquan giving back everything that was put on it. It just feels uncomfortable. Sometimes you do have to force yourself to take attacks. Liu Bingshuo there talking with Lin Shidong, Wang Chuqin, Xiao Zhan in the red jacket. The crowd. Oh, the crowd.
Luke warms up. You see the intention there completely from Lin, but yeah, the ability of top players to be able to come over a ball that looks barely long enough to attack.
Yeah, it felt like what you would call a float serve, not so heavy spin, but yeah, that extra bit of comfort at the back of the table. terms of intention, I still feel it. I think Lin Minru is doing what he has to do, take his shots. At this point, actually more so than before. And Liang Jingkun is so well prepared, so versatile in the rallies. From the blocking game, even in this replay, you can see how far out in front he holds the racket. He can recoil if he needs. But that wince there, you just hope that Lin Minru is not in pain. Didn't show much if he was before.
I hope he's not in pain, the net there for Liang, but Liang is being incredibly intelligent. He's playing a slower flick, which is making Lin Minru make a more physical shot over the top, and then Liang is stretching him wide. It's playing into that. Really, really aware tactics.
Grunt for grunt, it's Liang Jingkun to find that deep backhand corner. Score line here. You remember game number one, Lin Minru made quite a string of points. But the way Liang Jingkun's playing, the determination, I mean, I can't remember the last time I saw a big comeback against him.
2-7.
You've got quite a brain for history and a bit of a Wikipedia-like knowledge of the game.
Don't
anything
flatter
comes
me.
What's that?
Don't flatter me, Adam.
Oh, okay. Well, here's what I really... No, I'm just kidding.
What were you saying, sorry?
7-3.
Well, after acknowledging this incredible backhand, I was curious if you can recall a time where someone got the best of Liang Jingkun when Liang Jingkun was way ahead.
Ooh, let me try and look through the archives a second.
Sure.
That's a good point. I can't really recall anyone making a huge comeback. I can recall Liang making a massive comeback.
That's a nice thing to have in your pocket, right? Coach Wei here watching closely. He's coached in Japan. Has coached out in Elon. On the move, a save. It's not going to be a dependable way to get a point, but you can't look back. And once you're in that position, Lin Minru doing his best to make his case for winning the point. Yeah, when we talk about dependability, what really makes a player someone that you can trust to bring home a gold medal at the biggest events, take home the titles that China cares the most about? That ability to come back when you're behind and to win when you're expected. Those two factors are going to be huge. And inside the table, Liang Jingkun, aggressive, touch play, whatever it needs to be, he finds a way to take authority here and steal the attack from Lin Minru.
Such forwards energy.
So after all that forward energy, both have improved their service percentages quite a bit. Liang Jingkun still under 50%. Fascinating. 4 serving 9.
Oh, a fault.
That a fault?
Sorry.
I thought I heard that. Faulted on serve. It's going to cost him the point.
Four.
Tough time. So, 6 match points for Liang Jingkun. And we couldn't see the assistant umpire to see what the call was for. Maybe tossed inside the line. But no time to speculate. A salute to the Chinese team and the fans here. Liang Jingkun getting the best of an outstanding player getting revenge. For